So let's talk about pieces. Linguists and philosophers often think of sentences as being either true or false. It's just part of their meaning. But what about the bits and pieces that make sentences up? Words like all or some, or phrases like lives in LA, or helps the helpless. Our success in finding out how true or false they can be is predicated on us donning our logic hats and doing a little investigating. And maybe checking out our previous episode on the topic to cover the basics, cause it's gonna get technical in here. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
If you think back to when we introduced logic, we talked about how it was first developed by the Greek thinker Aristotle to get a better handle on why some kinds of arguments were convincing while others weren't. We also learned that philosophers developed sentential logic as a way of expanding on what that original system could do. Aristotle's approach couldn't really deal with complex sentences, and it didn't really have a good way of talking about individuals, only groups. So the artificial language of sentential logic was designed to use the letters of the alphabet to stand in for any of the sentences you can find in a natural language. Take a pair of sentences like, "The powers that be sent Cordelia a vision. She received it." We could symbolize the first sentence with, say, an S for sent, and the second one with an R for received. To symbolize words like and or, people invented logical connectives, so we could represent the way that bigger sentences can be built up out of smaller ones. All we need to do to put our two sentences together in a natural way is to use this symbol for and. With this system in place, linguists can then use the well-understood properties of logic to think and talk about the less well-understood properties of language. Like, take our now-completed stuck-together sentence. In logic, the whole sentence is true only when both halves are true, and since English seems to mostly work the same way, and the word and acts just like its logical cousin, we can suppose their meanings, their semantics, are the same. And we can represent the semantics of a logical connective with a truth table that describes it. So we can do the same for English. With this method, and in English becomes just like our little logical truth monster, munching on truths and falsehoods and spitting out the results according to the table. And we've managed to chip away a little bit at the semantics of a natural language using the chisel of logic. Since this works for words like or and if and not as well, it could turn out that just by speaking a language, you know a lot more logic than you ever realized. Now, if we want to get the most out of using logic as a model for understanding natural human language, we need to tweak it a bit. After all, language is more than just some letters strung together with a handful of symbols. We've got verbs and prepositions and tense and number and person. Language is jam-packed. We need to get inside sentences too, and sentential logic just isn't up to the task. Thankfully, philosophers noticed this too. They saw its limitations and realized that just like Aristotle's logic, there are some things that sentential logic can't do. Like, take the fact that the following argument is definitely a valid one. None of Angel's friends hang out with vampire hunters. Connor hangs out with Holtz, and Holtz is a vampire hunter. So, Connor is no friend of Angel. If we symbolize this using only the tools of sentential logic, we get this. But that argument doesn't hold up. None of the symbols even have anything to do with each other. Like, how do we get from an N, a C, and an H to an F? Sentential logic treats sentences as indivisible atoms, and so it can't see what's going on inside the sentences. It has no way of relating the contents of these sentences to each other. So, we need to crank up the power. To deal with a problem like this, we need predicate logic. Predicate logic has all the tools of sentential logic, but it replaces the simple sentences we've been using so far with something a bit more fine-grained, predicates. Intuitively, predicates are like properties of things, like green or immortal, but predicates can also be actions, like bites, or even states of being, like is a vampire. Generally, predicates are the sorts of things that can be true of something, like how Lorne is green, or how Angel is a vampire. So you can cut up the meaning within a sentence into idea chunks that fit together. To symbolize predicates, we use the same alphabet we were using before, but with some extra variables. We add the variables after the predicate, so it's easier to keep track of how many things are missing before the predicate can become a full-fledged sentence. So green could be GX, where the X lets us know that it needs one thing to be green. And bytes could be BXY, where the X says that this predicate needs a biter, and the Y tells us that something needs to get bitten. Unlike sentences in sentential logic, though, predicates on their own can't be true or false. If we want them to have some value, we have to apply them to something to fill in those variables. So we introduced a few individuals into the mix using lowercase letters, like writing GL to mean Lauren is green, or BDA for Darla Bit Angel. Now, both sentences are complete at last, and they're both true. And since predicate logic otherwise works just like sentential logic, we can stick the two sentences together. And so we can say, Lauren is green and Darla Bit Angel is also true. Predicate logic is so powerful that it can fully capture almost every sentence we can think of. But we still need to cover the area that Aristotle had mastered with his logic, describing groups of individuals. That's because even though predicate logic is much more useful and much less ambiguous than Aristotle's, it still has no way to explicitly talk about collections of things. For that, we have to add one more piece to our puzzle, quantifiers. Quantifiers are the symbols that stand in for the words all and some, and historically we write them out with an upside-down A and a backwards E. Quantifiers let us create all sorts of new sentences, like, all of Angel's friends are good guys would look something like this. Since that little arrow stands in for the phrase if, then, this new quantified sentence literally means, for all the things under discussion, if those things are friends of Angel, then those things are also good guys. Clunky, but clear and unambiguous. And we can use quantifiers to talk about smaller groups of things too, like, for the sentence, some vampire has a soul, we would get this. Literally translated back to plain English, this sentence means, for at least one thing under discussion, that thing is a vampire and that thing has a soul. Again, it's hardly Shakespeare or even Joss Whedon, but it delivers the goods. And with quantifiers in the system, predicate logic can even explain why the argument we brought up earlier actually works, even when sentential logic made it look like it didn't. If it's true that none of Angel's friends hang out with vampire hunters, that Connor hangs out with Holtz, and that Holtz is a vampire hunter, predicate logic guarantees that Connor is no friend of Angel. That's exactly what we want. It might look a little scary at first, but we can understand how predicate logic works for us here by thinking of it as being a kind of subtraction. The predicates O and H in the first and second lines cancel each other out. And we drop the quantifiers because by the second line, we've replaced all of our variables with individuals, so we don't need them anymore. All that's left over is negation and the sentence, Connor is a friend of Angel. Put it together and we get, Connor is no friend of Angel. And even if you haven't mastered predicate logic yet, the connections between the sentences are a lot more obvious here than they were with sentential logic. So it's much easier to see where the conclusion comes from. It doesn't just pop magically into existence out of nowhere. And it's all because predicate logic lets us peek inside of our sentences to see what they're made of. Finally, just like how sentential logic gave us the tools to understand connectives, predicate logic gives us what we need to start thinking about the meanings of other words. Verbs and adjectives and all these other predicates all have these logical meanings. And that means, if we wanted to, we could build truth tables for our predicates too, just like with the connectives. So the meaning of a predicate like is a vampire or VX would just be a list of all the individuals that it could possibly apply to, followed by true in all the cases where it does. So, Angel is a vampire, Buffy is not, neither is Cordelia, but Darla is, etc. And if a phrase like is a vampire acts enough like its symbolic version, we can suppose that the meaning of the phrase is the same sort of thing, a kind of truth table that picks out all the real-world individuals the phrase applies to. This way, logic gets us closer and closer to understanding what speakers must know when they know the meanings of words. Of course, there's still more work to be done, since we haven't even come close to covering all the categories and concepts that you find across the world's languages. But now that we're able to crack open our sentences and take a look at the pieces inside, our investigation has become a lot more meaningful. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you subtracted out the right variables, you learned that sentential logic isn't powerful enough to describe a natural language like English. That predicate logic improves our understanding by breaking sentences up into pieces, adding variables and quantifiers to the mix. And that with careful investigation, it could turn out that the semantics of logic offers greater insight into the semantics of natural language. The Ling space is produced by me, Moti Lieber, and directed by Delenise Prévost. This week's episode is written by Stefan Hurtubise. Our editor is Georges Coulomb, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and why not drop by our new store? And if you want to keep expanding your own personal link space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Mirupafsi!